In this video, we will look more closely at each component of the system. Here, we report the topology of a generic standalone system with storage for powering both AC and DC loads. Although the solar panels are the heart of a PV system, many components are required for a working system. Let's divide these components into three main groups. In blue, we have the PV panels and in general all the components generating power. Then, in red, we have all the other devices required for a working system, which are called the balance of system or BOS. Finally, there are the loads, which can require direct or alternating current. In the same way, we can divide the components of a grid-connected PV system in several groups. Again, we have PV panels at the generation side, then the balance of system, which is much simpler than in the previous case, and finally the outputs, which are the AC load and the grid. Here, all the components required by a PV system are summarized. In addition to the previous slides, we have the bypass diode that are part of the PV panel. We have cables and mounting frames in the BOS. Which components are required depends on whether the system is connected to the electricity grid or is designed as a standalone system. So, let's get familiar with these components. We start with the generation part of the PV system, which are the solar cells. The task of a solar cell is to generate electricity. Using a single solar cell, however, is not practical for most of the applications. This is because a single solar cell delivers a limited amount of power under fixed current and voltage conditions. In order to use solar electricity in practice, a number of solar cells have to be connected together to form a solar module or PV module. As discussed in the photovoltaic technologies course, there are multiple technologies available on the market. These technologies can roughly be divided into two groups, namely the wafer-based crystalline silicon modules and those based on thin film technologies. They involve different ways on how to connect the cells together. Nowadays, wafer-based crystalline silicon PV modules occupy about 90% of the market globally, while the rest of it is occupied by thin film PV modules. Of course, they have different market purposes. Thin film modules can be made flexible and are therefore suitable for niche markets related to building integrated photovoltaic, or more generally, for environmental integrated photovoltaics. After solar cells have been connected together, modules are formed by encapsulating the cells with different materials. The encapsulant is added to protect the cells from environmental influences. Finally, concerning large-scale generation of electricity, multiple PV modules are combined to form an array. In many modules, there are other important components. The first is the bypass diode, usually placed in the junction box of the module. It protects solar cells to avoid a so-called hotspot. Hotspots will be discussed later in the course. The second is the blocking diode, which prevents current from flowing from external circuit into the PV module. So, what are now the components making up the balance of system? Here we have the mounting structure that mechanically fixes the modules and arranges them towards the sun with the optimal tilt angle. Then, there are cables that are used to connect the different components of the PV system to each other and to the electric load. It is important to choose cables of sufficient thickness in order to minimize resistive losses. Storage devices like batteries are also instrumental in standalone systems. The batteries provide a reliable source of power. As long as they are well maintained, they assure that loads receive needed power during the night and in periods of bad weather. However, the balance of systems components do have some drawbacks. When adding a component, the efficiency of the PV system decreases. This applies also for batteries, since they exhibit some thermal and chemical losses. In addition, they have to be replaced more often than other electrical components in your system. So, when you want to have a PV system with storage, you have to take that into account. The PV modules are characterized by a certain lifetime, usually 25 warranted years. The batteries, however, have a much shorter lifetime of somewhere between 5 and 10 years. On the market, there are many types of batteries, but for PV applications, often lead-acid batteries are used. They are somewhat similar to those used in cars, except for some special design considerations aimed to prolong lifetime. Equally important to consider is the economic impact on the overall system expense. When you need a lightweight system or high storage capacity, the use of lithium-ion technology is preferable, but also more expensive. Lastly, it is also important to account for safety regarding thermal control and health concerns on the chemistry employed. Then we have power electronics in PV systems, conditioning power flow from the PV array to the rest of the system. DC-DC converters change the PV module output, depending on the time of the day, on the weather conditions, and on the connected loads, PV modules might work at a voltage far from optimal. The DC-DC converter applies a suitable voltage to the PV modules for maximal power transfer to the load. DC-AC converters, also known as inverters, are used in grid-connected systems. The inverters convert the DC electricity coming from the PV modules into sine-based AC electricity form that can be fed into the grid after supplying the loads. Of course, we have also standalone inverters that just change the PV power coming from the module to AC power that is delivered to a certain load. Both types of inverters are characterized by high conversion efficiencies between 94 and 98%, depending on the working conditions and on their embodiments. Furthermore, inverters can contain an additional board in the circuitry for actuating a maximum power point tracking strategy. As a result, the PV module can operate at the maximum power point voltage. As a matter of fact, many inverters have embedded a DC-DC converter to change the variable voltage of the PV array to a constant voltage that is the input for the actual DC to AC converter. We will discuss maximum power point tracking in more detail later in this course. Finally, the charge controller is used in PV systems to control charging and discharging of the battery. The charge controller is a three-port terminal. One port, you plug the PV panels, on another the load, and on the third the batteries. Some models of charge controllers contain also a DC-DC converter alongside a maximum power point tracker. This is added to decouple the voltage and current of the PV modules from the voltage and current of the battery bank. In this way, we can always obtain the maximum power from the modules. Though not part of the PV system itself, the outputs have to be taken into account during the design phase. Outputs include all the connected electric appliances and the grid. They must be considered in terms of required voltage levels, power consumption in case of loads, and AC or DC current. Now, it is the time to recap what we have seen in this introduction chapter. The electricity network of the future integrates renewable energy sources that can not only generate power in solar and wind farms, but also on-site. As a consequence, the electricity distribution becomes decentralized and bidirectional. We have discussed the different types of PV system, such as a standalone PV system and a very simple grid-connected system. In this video, we have also given a brief overview of the components forming PV systems, such as the PV modules, the balance of systems, and the outputs.